child. You may not know me, but I know everything about you. I know when you sit down and when you rise up. Even the very hairs on your head are numbered. For you are made in my image. In me you live and move and have your being. I determined the exact time of your birth and where you would live. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Every good gift that you receive comes from my hand, for I am your provider and I meet all of your needs. I want to show you great, marvelous things. Because I love you with an everlasting love. My plan for your future has always been filled with hope, and I rejoice over you in singing. If you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. I'm also the Father who comforts you in all your troubles. When you are brokenhearted, I am close to you. As a shepherd carries a lamb, I have carried you close to my heart. One day, I will wipe away every tear from your eyes. If you receive the gift of my Son, Jesus, you receive me, and nothing will ever separate you from my love again. I am your Father. I have always loved you, and I will always love you. My question is, will you receive my love?
Well, good morning. Good morning. It's great to see everybody here. Let's stand up. And let's start this morning off with worship.
Good morning, Fellowship of the Rockies. Welcome. We are so excited that you're joining us this morning, whether here live or online. It's so good to see you. This afternoon at 3 p.m., there is a very important meeting to attend if you want to go to the Juarez missions trip. So 3 p.m. today for that. Also, please mark your calendars for November 8th. There will be an all-church annual meeting, and we hope you'll join us. As most of you know, the Fall Festival is a really big deal here at Fellowship of the Rockies, and this year it's going to look a little bit different. We're going to have what's called the Shine On Drive-Through, and that's going to be Saturday, October 31st from 4 to 6 p.m. You can participate by decorating your car. You can dress up if you'd like and join the drive-through. While staying in cars, the kids will hear a gospel message, build a craft, plus they'll receive a bag of candy. This is a free event. There's no charge. It's a great community outreach, so be sure to invite your friends and your neighbors so they can come out too. And we'll have a lot of fun in a safe and creative environment. Also, please don't forget to fill out your Connect card so that we know you are here today with us. You can do that online or here in your bulletin. Also, giving is a form of worship, and so if you'd like to give today, you can do so through the giving boxes we have here in the church, the collection boxes, or also online at forchurch.org/give. And lastly, if you have a prayer request, it's such an honor as a staff to pray for the church, so please make sure we know your prayer needs. And let's continue to worship.
guys, just real quick. Anybody here got something on their mind besides God? Got a lot going on, right? Today in our series, we're talking about worship, specifically corporate worship. What God has for the community in this thing that we do. And so I'd like to just encourage us for just a second. Just everyone bow their heads and stop. For our family worshiping online and the increased distractions, wherever you are, stop. God, I realize that we have your attention right now. You are gazing from the throne room at us. God, I pray that you would have our attention as well.
Touching every heart, I worship you, yes, I worship. You are here, healing every heart, I worship you, I worship. You are here. Turning lives around, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, bending every heart, I worship you, I worship you. We make a miracle work, amen.
stop working, never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never
sing it together.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop. You know, we have all these small words that we use to describe you because we don't have anything that is as amazing, as glorious as you are. It's impossible to even comprehend all the things that you've done, all the things that you can do. You create all the planets, all the stars, all the galaxies, the universe. And us with our limited knowledge, we cannot comprehend how amazingly ginormous, how vast that is. And even with all these huge things, you love us. These tiny creatures. We thank you. That is why we lift our hands. That is why we lift our voices to praise. Because even though we are sinners, you love us. I give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey guys, what great worship. Jordan, perfect prayer for my message. Thank you. I appreciate that. All right, you guys can have a seat. Malachi 1, we'll get there in a little bit. I want to start by just doing a personal family thing here. I don't know how people found out about it. I never said anything publicly. We never sent an email, but many of you guys heard that Christy's dad passed away a couple weeks ago. The funeral was last Saturday. And on behalf of the McWilliams family, we just want to say thank you. Your love, your kindness, your prayers, your cards, your texts, your emails, all of that just was so thoughtful for us. And, we had the service on Saturday, and, Dad's life was celebrated, and the name of Jesus was lifted up, and the McWilliams, Maxwell, Mitchell family sorrow, but we sorrow with hope. The day we see Jesus is the day we see Dad. And that makes a difference, friends. That makes a difference. So thank you. All right, so Welcome back to questions, week two of questions, answers, and promises. We're journeying through the book of Malachi. As you heard last week, Malachi is sort of this, it's this book where God makes a statement. The people question God's statement. God answers their question and makes an incredible promise along the way. Last week was about God's love, and this week is about corporate worship and what it means for us to worship God. So let me sort of just lay out where I'm going to go today. We're going to have a rather lengthy conceptual introduction. You know, maybe 30% of the message is going to be an introduction. We're going to explore, like, what does it mean to do corporate worship, and what does that look like? What are the concepts about that in the Old and then New Testaments? And then we're going to look at the passage and the text that gives us three incredible attitudes that we all need to bring to worship today. And then we're going to end with talking about how we worship when we leave, because that's equally important. It's not just about how we worship God when we're together, but how we worship God when we leave. What is corporate worship? I read last week that corporate worship could be described as a celebration of being in relationship with the living God. One of the big things that church does is set aside a specific time and a specific place for us to come together to celebrate having a relationship with the King of Kings, with the Lord of Lords, with the Creator of the universe, with the one who spoke the worlds into existence. Guys, we celebrate together today the fact that we are in relationship with Him. Come on now, guys. Guys, come on. If there was nothing else for you to be excited about, we celebrate being in relationship with Him. And as we are going to see, that this corporate celebration of relationship with Him is very important to God. All right, so let's go back to the Old Testament. So when the Israelites came, when the Israelites worshiped, they went to Jerusalem to the temple of God to worship God in the temple. And when they did that, they were to bring a sacrifice, a gift of an animal, something from their flocks, or a gift of some kind. And some of that was very detailed and spelled out. And other times it was just a free will offering. But we see every time that the children of Israel came to worship God, they brought a sacrifice to Him. And now it's important for us to understand that God required this, celebrates it, loves it, all that good stuff, not because He needs it, but because we need it. Guys, God doesn't need the sacrifice of our praise. God doesn't need our gifts, our offerings, our service, our worship. He knows we need that, because He knows that when we do that, we recognize that He is everything to us. He's what's most important to us. Now, when the children of Israel, as was happening here, was refusing to offer righteous, pure, good sacrifice and gifts to God, what they were doing is they were saying to God, God, you're really not that important to me. Guys, what we clearly know in the Old Testament is sacrifice and worship go hand in hand. there is a strong link between this idea of sacrifice and worship. They're one and the same. And the best story of this is the story of Abraham. And I need to be quicker than I was in first hour with this. So I'm gonna do better. And you're gonna benefit about 5 minutes from this storytelling here.
Yeah.
All right, so story of Abraham, you might know it. God tells Abraham to sacrifice his son. And the scripture tells us that Abraham believed that he was going to sacrifice his son and God was going to give him back. He was going to bring him back to life. And the really important thing about the story is the words of Abraham in Genesis chapter 22. Abraham says, the boy and I are going to go worship God and we will come back. As he's literally taking his son to place him on the altar to sacrifice him, Abraham says, the boy and I are going to worship God. Worship and sacrifice go hand in hand. If you're not super familiar with the story, God provides a ram. Abraham never actually sacrifices his son, but God sees Abraham's heart and actions and loves it, honors it, provides a ram. The ram is sacrifice. And we learn the important principle that worship and sacrifice go hand in hand. Guys, so just from this rather lengthy introduction, we can draw that key truth conclusion. Worship and sacrifice are closely tied together, guys. Worship and sacrifice are tied closely together. Guys, they go hand in hand, and we need to pay attention to both. Now, in the Old Testament, one of the reasons why sacrificial gifts were given by the people was to provide an atonement or a makeup for the sins in their life. So when they came and they gave God a lamb, they said, okay, God, I sinned last week, and here's a lamb. Take this lamb as an atonement for my sin. Okay? Anybody mess up last week? Right? Well, good news is today, that's not why we sacrifice. That's not why we worship. As Jesus came 2,000-ish years ago, right? And he became the sacrificial lamb. And he died, and he made an atonement of the sins of last week, of last month, of last year, of the last 6,000, 7,000 years of human history, and for the next how many ever thousands of years of human history there might be, all those sins were atoned for in the work of Jesus Christ. And so what we did on Friday, we're coming today to worship God, and we're making a sacrifice of some kind. If nothing else today, you're making a sacrifice of time, right? You're sacrificing your time to be here to worship God, okay? So, and we aren't doing that hoping that God, that will cover our sins. We're doing that because we are thankful that Jesus Christ covered our sins. Guys, yeah, come on now. There's a couple good points, and they're all early on, because in a little bit it's not going to get good. So you better celebrate that. Woo! Guys, we come together and we sacrifice, we worship, we give God our praise out of thankfulness that Jesus Christ has paid for all of our sins. But back then that wasn't the case. They were doing it in hopes that that would cover their sins. Right? So they're giving something to God, hoping that God will forgive them for what they did on Friday night. Guys, today we're going to discover in this story with the people of Malachi's day and God, three important attitudes that should drive our worship, okay? And the first attitude is this: we need to put honor and respect back into worship. So the people in the time of Malachi, they had slipped into lazy worship. Their worship of God, their corporate gatherings, it really wasn't that important to them. They weren't listening to what God wanted, and it had gotten all messed up. Okay, so God says to them and to us in Malachi 1:6, a son honors his father and a slave his master. If I am a father, where is the honor due me? If I am a master, where is the respect due me? Says the Lord Almighty. It is you priests who show contempt for my name, but you ask, how have we shown contempt for your name? So God leads with an example that was very familiar in their culture. And I don't want to get down this rabbit hole and we could, you know, we could really get ourselves in trouble with. But that time today, slavery was a common practice, right? There was slaves everywhere. There was masters and there were slaves. And the scripture says that the slave is to respect the master. And so slaves respected their master. And at that time, it was clear that children were to honor their fathers. And God says to his children, to the priests, he's actually talking to priests, he's talking to the preachers, he says, okay, you honor your earthly father, you respect your earthly masters, but you don't show it to me. Even though I am your eternal father and your master. What's up with that? Okay. But these preachers fire back at Malachi with their own question. I mean, think of the arrogance here. Okay, have you been called on the carpet by the Holy Spirit because of your sin? I have. Has God ever used another human being to call you on the carpet because of your sin? Man, in all of those instances, I have never done what these guys did. They said to God and to Malachi, prove it to me. God, you prove what you're saying about me is true. Man, think of the arrogance here. Guys, today we often show contempt for God in our worship. When we come lazily to worship, when we don't engage, we're physically present, but emotionally, spiritually, mentally, we're gone. Instead of our attention being on the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, it's on, hey, I wonder how my fantasy team is doing, or man, did I miss a post? I wonder what, is the roast in the oven burning? I mean, all these things that are so unimportant are occupying our mind, our mental space, our emotional space, our spiritual lives. We disrespect God's table, his altar, when we do that. There's another attitude that we need to pay attention to, and that's don't make worship about you. The Israelites had made worship about them, about what they wanted, about what was good, what worked for them, about their schedules, their preferences, all that stuff. They made it about them. In the Old Testament, the people were only considering themselves. They were selfish. And so God answers their question to them this way. By offering defiled food on my altar. But you ask, it's not good. They're still asking. They're still challenging God. How have we defiled you? By saying the Lord's table is contemptible. When you offer blind animals for sacrifice, is that wrong? When you sacrifice lame or diseased animals, is that not wrong? Try offering them to your governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you, says the Lord Almighty? Okay, so let's just understand what the sacrificial system looked like, at least briefly in the Old Testament, right? Let's take a quick look at it. Again, God had specific things. Like he said, okay, you're to bring this lamb, and you're to sacrifice this lamb on the altar. You're bringing a lamb. And not only are you to bring a lamb, but you're to bring a good lamb. In fact, the best lamb you have. Okay, so there's two cases that were going on. It was part of the system. Not everybody was a shepherd back then. So some people had to go out and they had to buy a lamb, right? They had to acquire a lamb. They didn't have lambs. They were the store owners, innkeepers, whatever, tech gurus. I don't know. Whatever they were doing, but they had to get a lamb to go to church. I said, go down to the lamb market. I don't know if they had a lamb market, but there's some place, and there's 10 lambs. This lamb over here is $5. It's big and fat and fluffy and white and ready to shear, and it's going to make a lot of money to somebody, or whatever, right? And they got this scrawny little thing over here for 50 cents. And they have 50 bucks in their pocket. And do they buy the $5 one? No. They bought the 50 cent one. Take it down to the preacher. They say, hey, preacher, here's my lamb. And the preacher says, looks good to me. And then worse yet, the people who were shepherds, they had the flock. They've got 100 sheep out there in their flock. They go out into the pen, they got the big old fat fluffy thing, and that sheep is going to bring them $5 on Amazon. And this sheep is going to bring them 50 cents on Amazon. Which one do they bring? You got it. They take the 50 center down and they hand it to the preacher, and the preacher says, looks good to me. And God says, it doesn't look good to me. What you're telling me here, guys, is it that your $4.50 is more important to you than I am to you? He says, my table means nothing to you. You're disrespecting me in this action. And again, I'm not caring so much about being disrespected for me. I'm caring about what disrespecting me does to you. The outcome of that in your life. He said, you know, you wouldn't do this to the governor. If the governor said, hey, bring me a good lamb, what would you do? You'd bring the governor a good lamb. So why do I get the second-rate stuff? Verse 9 in the NIV says, now plead with God to be gracious to us. With such offerings from your hand will he accept you, says the Lord Almighty. Yeah, it's confusing. I actually love the New Living Translation rendition of this verse. It says, go ahead, beg God to be merciful to you. But when you bring that kind of offering, why should he show any favor at all? I mean, that's a real question, guys. When worship is about us, when it's about what I want, it's about what makes me happy, why should that motivate the eternal God of the universe? And guys, that happens so easily today, guys. We easily make worship about us. You know, so often my worship experience and the way I approach worship, it is like I'm selecting a movie to go to. You know, I'm in the mood today for an action adventure, so hopefully there's a lot of energy. Hopefully the drums are nailing it, Donnie. Jess, I want you bouncing a little bit today. Because I'm in the mood for action. Or, you know what, I've had a rough week. Hope there's some candles. I want it to be sort of like a romantic comedy that everybody feels good at the end. So could you tone it down? And all of that is making worship about me and my preference instead of making it about the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, my Savior who died so that I might live. Guys, worship at its very core is all about God. Okay, the third and last attitude is, we bring your best to worship. Now, this doesn't mean wear your Sunday best. And like a lot of us growing up, we're hammered. You know, we had to wear suits and ties 30 years ago because that was bringing your best to worship. Guys, that really doesn't have anything to do with it. Man, this is talking about heart and attitude, attention, focus, concern, not looking right. The people in Malachi's day, we're clearly bringing their less than their best to God. And so this is what God says in verse number 10. Oh, that one of you would shut the temple doors. He's talking to the preacher. He said, heck, the governor don't need to shut you down. You need to shut you down. Why? So that you would not light useless fires on my altar. They're the fires that they were burning these sacrifices to God. He said, this is nothing, guys. It's a waste of time. Save the match. I am not pleased with you, says the Lord Almighty, and I will accept no offering from your hands. My name will be great among the nations, for where the sun rises to where it sets, in every place, incense and pure offerings will be brought to me because my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord Almighty. But you profane it by saying, the Lord's table is defiled and his food is contemptible. Verse 13, and you say, what a burden. And God, you don't understand how hard it is to come to church. I had to get the kids ready. Oh my. I'm going to miss the kickoff of the game. And you sniff at it contemptuously, says the Lord Almighty. When you bring injured, lame, or diseased animals and offer it to them as sacrifices, should I accept them from your hands? God's saying to the children of Israel and to us, I'd rather you stay home. I'd rather you give nothing than what you're doing now. Okay, so we put some context in it. I know right about now. Well, half the people online, they just turned it off. It's enough of this stuff, right? And you're sitting here and say, this is really bad. So let me give you a little bit of context. We've all had days. In fact, today might be that day for you, that you're just going through the motion. Yeah, you got up, it's got to go to church, they opened the doors back up, we haven't been, you know, whatever, right? And you're just going through the motions. I get that. Guys, I have days. I have a bad week, and I wake up, I say, I'm going to go down there, I'm going to do that message, I'm going to smile at people, I'm going to go home, watch football, get this church thing over with, and I'm the preacher. We all have those days. But for the children of Israel, this had been going on for 100 years. Week after week, year after year, decade after decade. And here God says, I've had it. Not because I need it. Not because my ego needs to be fed. Because you need to understand that without me, you have nothing. You have nothing. Okay, so how do we bring our best to worship? Let me just give you a couple things and we'll wrap up here. Well, we bring our best to worship when we come with an open heart to engage with God. Guys, this thing, this emotional center of our lives, that needs to be open to God right now for 55 minutes. When we come expecting the Holy Spirit to work on us. Guys, did anyone enter in here perfectly? Does someone not need the work of God in their life? We come humbly with anticipation. That when we offer praise to God in our song, that the King of Kings hears that and is going to do something with that. We bring our best to Him. When we come with gifts that are pleasing, when we're generous with service, and when we engage like we're genuinely brothers and sisters in Christ. I got to do it. Just two more minutes, guys. I get that every week it's a rush in. We're running late. You're running late. You know, every traffic light was red on the way. I get that. But you can make the choice to not rush out. What do I mean here? Guys, every single person here is important to God. If you're worshiping with anyone else remotely, everyone is important to God. Would you give them some attention as you leave our time of worship? Smile with your eyes through the mask. Take a second and find out what happened this week in their lives. And then as we go, we have the opportunity to worship, guys, all week long, every single minute of every single day. In fact, Corinthians tells us that the temple is no longer in Jerusalem. You know where the temple is? Right here. Yeah, so you go like that. You got it. God says that the temple of God is the body of a believer. So that means every place our physical body goes is an opportunity to worship God. You slide into the office tomorrow morning. Worship God. You sit down at your desk in front of your teacher. Worship God. You play. You have dinner. Worship God. All of that, every single one of those things is an opportunity for you to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So it leaves us to decide, okay, are we going to give God the honor and respect due? Are we going to make it about Him and not us? And are we going to give Him our best? Guys, the last thought is, worship that we are fully engaged in is the best worship of all. Let me pray. God, thank you for our time. Thank you for giving us your attention. It's got to be better things than us, but yet not to you. You're anxiously looking over the portals of heaven, hanging on every word, every heartbeat, every thought that comes from Fellowship of the Rockies today. Thank you. God, we want to give you our attention, not just in the last 4 minutes of the song, but every breath of every day, because you are worth it. And I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, let's stand for one more song.
Show me who.
See, I'll build my life.
Let's pray that we take everything that we heard this morning and that when we go out of these doors, everything that we do will be for you, to glorify you, to worship you, whether that's at home, whether it's at work, whether it's at school, whatever it may be, we do everything to give you the glory. Only you and you alone deserve the glory. Not ourselves, not any of these gods that we as humans have created. Only you. So we love you. Give you all the praise. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you guys for joining us. We look forward to seeing you next week.
chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished.